an edition of the award-winning Flintoff Savage and the Ping Pong Guy. That comes after the 1 o'clock news with Rob Watts.
More live Premier League football than anyone else. This is BBC Five Live.
Labour's Liz Kendall and Diane Abbott are among the MPs who are calling for more to be done to tackle sexual harassment at Westminster. It follows a series of claims about inappropriate behaviour. Liz Kendall's been speaking to Five Live.
What are the reasons why women don't speak out? They fear they won't be believed, they don't want to damage their career, and also they don't want to damage the reputation of the party they love and care about. So alongside the proposals we've already got, I would like to see an independent third-party reporting system and some specialist independent advice for the party too.
It comes as parliamentary officials are investigating whether the International Trade Minister, Marc Garnier, broke the ministerial code. He's admitted asking his secretary to buy sex toys. Tens of thousands of people are demonstrating in Barcelona in favour of Spanish unity after Catalonia's disputed declaration of independence. Madrid has sacked the regional parliament and voted to impose direct rule, although the former Catalan leader Carles Puigdemont is opposing that. Nicola Sturgeon will apologise to gay men in Scotland who've previously been convicted of offences that no longer exist. The First Minister's speech next month will also mark the introduction of new legislation that will automatically pardon those affected. Tim Hopkins is director of the charity The Equality Network.
I was talking to a man the other day who had a conviction in 1990 for simply kissing his boyfriend in the street in Glasgow. He was fined £150. But that conviction has been on his criminal record ever since because he works with disabled people. So it's really affected his career for 25 years. The pardon will be really important for him.
A 15-year-old boy is critically ill after falling from a bridge at Manchester's Trafford Centre. Police were called to the shopping centre at around 8:15 last night. And the government's hoping to collect hundreds of thousands of pounds in missing child maintenance payments each year by closing a legal loophole. At the moment, deductions can't be taken out of joint accounts, only ones held in the name of a single person.
BBC Sport.
It's that time. We're back. FA Cup Round 1. This is our tournament. This cup is second to none. So represent. No chances for revenge. It's survival of the fittest. Who will take it to the end? Keep your eyes on the prize. Get the first round done. Who's ready? It's winner stays on.
The FA Cup on the BBC.
Hyde United versus MK Dons. Friday night from 7:30 on BBC Two. And for the full list of match commentaries, go to bbc.co.uk/FA Cup.
This is Five Live Sport with Jonathan Overend.
And in the Championship, they're about to get underway in the second half at St Andrews. Birmingham against Aston Villa. Here's Robin Cowan.
0-0 at the break here at St Andrews. Clear-cut chances at a premium. Villa starting the better. Terry and Codger with tame efforts at goal. Birmingham grew stronger as the half went on. Isaac Vassell had a couple of opportunities, but he was forced off in stoppage time due to injury. Sam Gallagher, his replacement. Great atmosphere. Just needs a goal. Birmingham 0, Aston Villa 0.
Birmingham City ladies are one up on Manchester City in WSL 1. That's a match that you can watch right now on the red button or through the BBC Sport website and app. Later, Chelsea, Yeovil and Everton Arsenal both starting at 2 o'clock. And that Everton Arsenal match is a Five Live Sports Extra commentary on air just before 2 o'clock. Also underway, by the way, BBC Two's coverage of the NFL at Twickenham this afternoon. Minnesota Vikings, Cleveland Browns with kickoff at 1:30. Other sports news this Sunday. England have reduced the deficit in the Women's Ashes to 2 points with victory over Australia in the third one-day international. They won by 20 runs under the Duckworth-Lewis method. That in Coffs Harbour. The Test match is next, starting on the 9th of November. Justin Rose has won the HSBC Champions Golf in Shanghai. Fantastic final swing for him. He was 8 shots off the lead going into the final round. 6 off the lead with the back 9 remaining, but he shot a final round 67 to finish on 14 under for the tournament as his rival, the world number one, Dustin Johnson, collapsed and hit a final round 77. Anthony Joshua's promoter, Eddie Hearn, says he'd like to see a fight between Joshua and Tyson Fury next year if Fury returns to boxing. We'll talk with Costello and Bunce after 2. And Lewis Hamilton will start the Mexican Grand Prix. Third on the grid, Sebastian Vettel pole. Hamilton needs to finish 5th or better to win the Drivers' Championship for a 4th time. Commentary on Five Live begins at 6:30 this evening. Right, next on Five Live Sport, another chance to hear the latest episode of Flintoff, Savage and the Ping Pong Guy.
magic number. Three. Yes, it is. It's the magic number.
What does it all mean?
Hello and welcome to the multi-award-winning podcast, Flintoff Savage and the Ping Pong Guy. It was, of course, our very good friend, Matthew Saeed. I can't carry on this anymore. I know I should be presenting this because I did win Best New Presenter of a show that I don't even present.
I'll tell you, talk about rubbing it in. I was already upset that I didn't get even nominated for that award, despite being the presenter. You go and win it, and then you hog the opening line.
So the big question is, why are you here?
What do I contribute to this thing?
Well, Matthew, show us what you've got. You pick it up now. I've tried. Go on, tell us what we're doing this week.
This week, we're all going to talk about getting criticised in sport, the greatest team of all time in any sport. And remember, you can use the hashtag FredSavSide, get in touch through the week and suggest future topics. But let's talk about the Radio Academy Awards. I mean, unbelievable night for this podcast.
How do you know you weren't there?
Yeah, where were you?
You were taking cash, weren't you, for a speaking gig. You didn't fancy coming out. All this work we've put in, this was our moment.
So I followed some of this on Twitter. You very generously phoned me as you were on the way back from the awards ceremony. I hadn't a clue that we'd won so big, and it was great to hear from you. I've heard a rumour that you got up and gave a speech, didn't you?
Yeah, it wasn't a very good one. I don't know where I was going.
It was all right, it was good.
Was it good?
Well, to be fair, Freddie, people love Freddie, and I went there. I think I was boring him. I didn't know where I was going with it. And then my first line was Leeds, you know, not sure many people like me. And then his line was...
Oh, I said, look at Robbie, he thinks it's just Leeds fans who don't like him. Got a nice
hand. Brought the house down, well done, Fred.
It was really nice. I'm
genuinely gutted I wasn't there. I love the fact that...
That was the one thing that was missing, to be honest with you, Matthew. It really was.
Thanks, Fred. And
John, I'm glad...
And the feedback from the audience, I think that made a big difference to the judges. Just seeing on Twitter the reviews that people leave, the dialogues we've been getting into, the emails that we've received from listeners who have been touched or moved by a particular topic that we might have done. Topic number one. Jose Mourinho criticised his team very strongly after their first league defeat of the season away to Huddersfield. He said, when you lose a match because of attitude, that's really bad. I don't even remember a friendly match when the attitude was so poor. We could have had a second goal, got a draw, but it would have been undeserved. If I was a United supporter, I'd be really disappointed because you can accept losing because the opponent had more quality, but not because the opponent had more attitude. In other words, Mourinho, he hammered his players. So the question we're going to ask now is, what is the worst criticism we have faced, received, as athletes, as sports people? How did we react? Is criticism always bad? Can it actually be a good thing? Fred?
I'm confused by this. Mourinho, what he said, are people saying he's out of order?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, like it's too tough on his players.
Really? I think...
Well, some people are saying that, right, Rob?
I think so, yeah.
If he thinks that, I think he's bob on. Yeah. You know, because for me, results and failures I can accept. Yep. What I cannot accept is people who don't try, who don't put 100% in, yep, including myself. Mm-hmm. If I played a game and I'd lost and I'd done everything I possibly could to perform on that day and it didn't work out, I can walk home happy. Them days when you know you could have done a little bit more, you could have put a bit more work in before the game in practice, you could have done something a bit more during the game, and you look at yourself in a mirror and you're disappointed. And I think Mourinho, if he thinks that, yep, he's the manager of Man United. He's accountable to his bosses. He's accountable to the fans, as are the players. Why should he not say that? If he feels they've let the fans down, yep, good on you, Jose.
A lot of people say, you know, sports people, young people, they don't really want to be criticised. It can bring them down. It might upset them. I mean, I think there is a big argument now about what is and what is not acceptable in terms of critiquing people in sport and in people's professional lives and so on. What you're saying is negative criticism can galvanise. It can help you see where you're going wrong. I mean, did you ever have anything personally in your cricket career where a coach or a mentor...
I wanted it. I don't know what you think here, Rob, but the worst thing for me was no feedback. I don't need to be told when I've done well. I know I've done well. In sports, measurable. What I didn't like is if a coach has got a problem with me or an issue, if he doesn't tell me, then I don't like that. Even now, doing this musical, this Fat Friends, yep, I hate it when you come off at the end and you've done a run-through of the show and then you get your notes.
Yeah.
And some people don't like getting notes or criticised. I want everything. I would sooner get 100 than one or two or none.
Because you see that criticism as something you can work on.
I want to improve. I want to be told. Even to the point of when we speak about mental health.
Yep.
the best thing for me was being told I had depression.
Yeah.
Because then I can do something about it. And that relates to everything in my life. I want to be told. I want to get better. I want to perform. And I've had coaches who did it. Bob Simpson was a coach at Lancashire, great Australian coach, took Australia from being a really bad team back in the 80s to a brilliant team.
Yeah.
And he changed the culture along with Alan Border. He sat me down in the dressing room at Old Trafford. He pulled me in one day, and it was a brief chat. He said, Fred, you're a very, very bad word. And then I thought, wow, here we go. And then he just unleashed on me. And I walked out of that room, half thinking, you know, a bit unsure, but half thinking, well, I'm going to do something about that now. Yeah. And I had that off David Lloyd, off Bumble. Bumble used to tell me exactly what he thought. And I can relate to that. And I can't get my head around people who can't.
Do you remember what the actual criticism was? What did he pick up on?
He didn't think I was working hard enough. I wasn't pulling my weight. I was overweight. I wasn't fit. I was underachieving. And he just spelt it all out.
Was it right? Was he right?
I couldn't fault a word that came out of his mouth. Duncan Fletcher, this is where our relationship broke down a little bit. Tell me.
Yeah.
If you've got a problem, come and have it out with me.
You know, I'm so glad you said that. I couldn't agree more. I think there's this phrase going around called snowflakes, people who can't take
criticism. Piers Morgan loves it, doesn't he?
I think he's right. You know, I'm going to mention him, and I'm sorry, but Ferguson gave a speech at the reopening of Salford Stadium the other day, and he said Eric Harrison was tough, but he created players with character who knew how to deal with adversity, because he would tell you if you weren't training hard enough. He would tell you if you weren't coming into the Cliff training ground without a professional attitude. There's a big load of scandals in Olympic sport at the moment where people who are carrying too many pounds have been told they're overweight, and they're like, oh, that's a very offensive thing to say. It's more offensive if you don't tell somebody they're carrying too many pounds. They get to the Olympic stadium and lose, and they've just wasted 4 years of their life. Yep. I mean, obviously there's a balance somewhere, but I think we've gone way, personally, we've gone way too far in trying to protect people from negative criticism when it can be a positive. It can tell you where you need to do things differently. Rob, what's the most powerful bit of criticism you've had?
Well, first and foremost, that game at the weekend, Huddersfield against United, the attitude of players, surely, you know, that comes from within. I watched Huddersfield in the first 5 or 10 minutes. They had two players who got yellow carded. It was, you know, wet conditions. They were smashing into tackles. And as somebody who played for the lesser teams in the Premier League against the big stars, you have to have a right attitude if you're going to win those games.
Yep.
If they have the same attitude as you, the opposition, then they're usually they're at the top of the league because of A, they have the right attitude, and B, they're better players. Mm-hmm. If they're slightly down, then you think you've got half a chance here. You know, but I'm not having people saying it's the manager's fault, because surely you have to motivate yourself and an attitude yourself. Yeah. This is what I don't get. If somebody kicked me, the next thing I'd be doing is going smashing into them back and thinking, right, I'm a better player than you.
Yeah.
I'd try to prove to people, even though I wasn't Steven Gerrard, Paul Scholes, the better players, that was my fire in my belly to say, do you know what? I'm going to show up. I'm as good as you. Because if I can match you physically and for desire and for, you know, all the horrible little piece of work, if I can match you in that, that's the least I can do.
Yep.
You might be able to do a trick, you might be able to go, you might be quicker than me. Mm-hmm. I can't deal with that. You know, I can't deal with that. That's life. But if I can match you in everything that I've got, my attributes, and then I lose, I can't do no more.
So you're with Mourinho then? They deserved it.
100%.
Why can he not criticise these players?
Of course he can. I watched that first half, and Huddersfield was quicker, they were stronger, they were flying the tackles, and it was like, it was the underdogs rose to the occasion. Yep. They were brilliant. Second half, when United, you know, needed, you know, the funny thing was, in an attitude, Mourinho, when a Mourinho side's been 2 goals down in the Premier League, they've never won.
Yeah.
So that is a question for another day.
That's interesting.
Why isn't a fantastic team, when they're 2-0 down, never come back and won a game? I used to get hammered, and that inspired me. I'm with you. That my problem was, as a player, that I would ring too many people.
To get their feedback?
Yeah, I'd ring too many people. So, for instance, I'd ring the never ring the manager. I'd ring the coach. I'd ring the fitness guy. I'd ring the newspaper reporter who was at the game. It's, you know, how did I play? You know, because did I play well? I knew myself had a good game, but the constructive criticism, what I can't accept is when people just hammer you for no reason. It's personal. That's ridiculous. And I have so many, though. That's just nonsense. That's just lazy.
Yeah, you get people. More. You get so much of that you do not deserve. Yeah. I'm laughing as I say it.
I mean, some he does, but yeah.
Some I do, some
yeah,
I do.
We all do, but some of it is just pathetic.
Yeah, pathetic.
It really is.
So, the criticism of Martin O'Neill when he said about I had no ability, which was tongue-in-cheek on the telly, and then I wanted to prove him wrong. Other people, I remember at half-time.
But do you know, like Martin O'Neill, with you there?
Yeah.
Is that just clever management?
Clever. He knew
what you was
he
about.
He knew exactly that would fire me up and say, I'm going to prove him wrong. And I'd get aggressive with myself. And, I can't wait for training. I'm going to go and smash into people. Yeah. I know I use the word smash into people. I don't mean, like, just go and kick people all over the place. I mean, in their faces.
Yeah.
And I do that in training. I want to be the best trainer. And I wasn't great, but if somebody told me constructively, you're not good at this, I'd try and get better.
Yeah.
And why can't these players of this day and age not accept it? Have they got, is there too much money? Hmm. You know, we can go about these young kids now. They all wear these spiky Christian Louboutin shoes for £400. They've got Louis Vuitton wash bags. They've got Range Rovers. this is about, seriously. I'm going off on one here. I'm saying
Joseph Hake one. Joseph Hake one.
But I'm seeing it now, man. Honestly, I'm seeing it now. We're talking about attitudes.
Yeah, no, you're right.
And I'm seeing it now. You know, it's all about attitude. And why can't these...
I've got a theory. I've got a theory on it.
Whoa.
I really have. Uh-huh. I think I've alluded to it in a previous podcast, but I think because... Now, and I've seen a taste of it, football academies, cricket academies, school, the way in which kids are schooled and brought up, everything's nice. Yeah. Everything's lovely. Let's do everything for these young lads. We want to make them into footballers. We make them into cricketers. And we'll take away all the stuff which life throws at you.
Yes.
Which actually shapes you. All the bad stuff, all the experience you gain through booking your own travel, by paying your own gas bill. This is life, but everything's taken away from a kid. And I think at times we're growing up in a culture where let's take the positive out of everything, even in the worst scenario, even when you've done badly. Oh, we can't say that to our poor little Johnny. Let's focus on the good things.
Yeah.
He's got 3% in a maths test. Let's not talk about 97%. Yeah. Let's talk about that one question you got right. No, let's not do that. Let's be realistic.
Just let me finish. Yeah.
And then as they move on and move on and move on, they get to a point, for instance, Man United against Huddersfield. Huddersfield, by no stretch, are as good a football team, in my limited knowledge.
Yeah, 100% right.
But what they've got is, they've got this fire about them. They know United are coming. We're going to kick them. We're going to be physical. We're going to move them around. We're going to make it uncomfortable for them. Because these lads don't experience that, and it's not their fault, where do they go? And I've seen it with other kids. If you're always winning, always told how good you are, always had things done for you, all of a sudden, if that's challenged, what is your default position? Where do you go? What do you do? They don't know.
I agree with absolutely everything there. And I think, you know, the theory you've just described, it tallies with everything we're learning in psychology. There's something called the self-esteem movement, where you want to build the self-esteem of young people, telling them how great they are, how wonderful, focusing only on their successes, never talking about anything negative. And the idea is they'll have so much self-esteem, they'll be able to do anything. What actually happens? They think they're wonderful, they think they're marvellous, and they hit one difficulty, one setback, one challenge in the real world, one failure, and they fall apart. Oh my God, I'm not as good as I thought I was. We don't want young people with self-esteem that is fragile, that's brittle, that they can't deal with anything. We want people with resilience who can face up to the setbacks that are inevitable in life. If you want to achieve anything great, you have to have the occasional setback, the occasional difficulty. It's what happens when you're in a competitive environment. And I think we protect people and wrap them in cotton wool. We're not giving them what they need to deal with the real world. I mean, obviously there's a balance. It doesn't mean that you hammer people and beat them up against the wall.
Just be honest.
Yeah, honesty, exactly.
I think that's what Mourinho's done.
Frankness.
I think that's what's missing. I think looking back at my career, I was at my worst when I was most successful. When I got to the top, I was at my worst because I was a bit bored. And then I'd jump off a cliff almost and I'd get back. My career...
The desire would come back.
It rocked bottom so many times through my career. And then once I got my head around it, that's actually when I'm at my most dangerous. When everyone's writing me off, when everyone's saying how bad I am, this is when I come into my own.
Yeah.
I used to love that piecing back together. I used to love the rise to the top.
Yes.
And I'm not saying I needed any more motivation because I love what I was doing, but I would lie. I'd be lying in saying that when people told me how bad I was, when people wrote me off saying I can't do this, can't do that, even now in some of the things I put, the positions I put myself in, this musical, for instance, this is when I'm at my most dangerous, is when people are telling me you cannot do something. It's, hang on a minute. Of course I can.
Yeah.
But when I get to, when I get there, I think, well,
it was like, it was like a derby. It was like a derby, Matthew. I'd come back from my broken leg. And when I moved to Derby, it was like, why are we signing him? And that was the occasion I went on the messaging boards, which he said in the previous
series. Stab the ram,
And I was awful. I was hopeless. People saying I was finished. People saying my legs had gone. And inside me, I thought, you know what? I'm not finished yet. It's not my time to finish. I'm going to prove people wrong. And I was turning up onto the pitch. I was training with the kids. I was going to training when the first team had days off, and this was it. This was my end. And I was saying, no, I'm going to, this is where, I totally agree with Fred, this is where I'm going to show people I've still got something left. And I got back in the side when Nigel Clough took over as manager, and we played in a game. I think it was Manchester United, and we lost 1-0. And I had man of the match, and the Derby crowd started singing, there was only one Robbie Savage, which was a bit bizarre. But that moment...
yeah.
I felt like saying, put my two fingers up to everybody and say, I told you, I told you. And it was such a satisfying moment that I got hammered criticism, which was probably right because I thought my legs had gone. But I thought, you know, I'm just going to fight for it and show character. But
just picking up on what Fred said about it being honest and frank, if you get that on Twitter or anywhere else, you think, yeah, I know what you're saying. That wasn't as good a column as it might have been. That podcast could have been a bit better or whatever. It's helpful. The only time I find it difficult is when it's kind of very personal. It's nothing about how you could improve. It's just telling you how horrible you are as a person. But that doesn't give you anything to work with. There's no raw material there.
But then I think about that and I think, you know what? It's probably some bloke sat at home with a load of cats. Right, and he's eating a Caramac and a pot noodle.
And Caramac,
he's
like,
they were good. And he's swigging on a bottle of Tizer.
Caramac.
And he thinks, you know what, I'm just going to have a go at someone here.
Yeah.
I feel more for that person doing that.
That's a good attitude, that. In fact, but talking of unfair criticism, when it's not been legitimate, hasn't been honest, or it hasn't been something that you felt was just. Have you had anything like that, Fred?
Loads. You know, I'm not going to lie. A lot of the criticisms I got as a player were deserved. And some of the things I did off the field, yeah, probably were deserved as well. And some of them got me a few jobs, so I'm not going to change them. but there's been a couple of times. One which stands out when you mentioned that was, I remember I got back into, I got in the England side and I was becoming quite an established player. And we played, I think it would have been, might have been, what, 2001 maybe, 2002. I don't know the dates. So we're playing against India in a test series, one-day series, and playing a game for Lancashire. I felt my groins had been building up. And this was in May. And I came off, and the physio, Dave Roberts, one of my great friends, he said, I think you've got double hernias. This was May, beginning of May. I said, all right. He said, what does that mean? He said, well, you'll get away playing for a while, but it's going to catch up on you.
Yeah.
So I went to England. And then said to him, look, I've got this problem with groins. He thinks it's double hernia. He said, nah, it'd be fine. So carried on playing. And then about July, then they diagnosed it as double hernias.
Right.
So I'm struggling. I'm on injections. I'm on painkillers. I'm getting through. And I played through till September. The last test match.
You played through with a double hernia?
From May to September.
Wow.
So the last test of the series was against India at Edinburgh. We needed to win. I got two ducks, and I didn't get any wickets. I turned up to the test match 3 days before. I didn't even take any kit. I've just gone in the car just to turn up and say I'm going home. So I turned up, no kit. I borrowed Army's kit to do warm-ups and everything. And then they come over and says, are you going to play this week? I said, well, I can't move. And they said, no, we'll sort that out. We'll look after you. We'll jab you up and that. So I said, fine. So all that's gone on. We didn't win, and moving on. We was going to Australia that winter in November.
Yeah.
So I've got to now get me. I've had my operation. They want me fit to go to Australia in November. I turn up. The first session we have, they're all gone on warm-ups. And I've started walking around the ground because I've been told I can't run. They know I can't run. I get pulled in Duncan Fletcher's office. He says, what are you doing? I said, I've had all hernias. I can't run. He says, yes, but when they said you can't run, I didn't know they couldn't run. I said, well, running is that thing where when you move quicker, 2 feet off the ground at the same time. I can't do it. I can't do it. So they kept me on tour. We played first test Brisbane. Nasser Hussain wins the toss at Brisbane and bowls. So I get brought up. I can field slip. I can't run, but I can field slip. So Simon Jones busts his knee. I go on a field slip. We don't have slips for very long because we're getting smashed. I then get put on the boundary. Matthew Aidan, it's one up in the air. If I'm fit, I get this ball. But I'm like trotting after this ball. Nasser Hussain throws his cap, sends me off. So I get sent off the ground.
Really?
Yeah. They keep me on tour for ages and we're getting beat and beat and beat every week. We're just getting hammered by every team we play against. And I'm just a tourist here. I'm just going round. So I don't know what happened. Duncan pulls me in the office, decides to let me know what he thinks of me, which I knew that anyway.
And what was he saying?
Well, he criticises me for not being fit, not being this, that and the other. And I was resorted to tears, actually. It was before a team meeting.
Really?
Because you can have a go at me for a lot of things. Have a go at me for drinking, have a go at me for going out, have a go at me for doing all this, but do not have a go at my intentions and attitude and trying.
And you're playing through a double hernia all the way through that period.
And I couldn't get fit, so... He then decides he's going to send me home, which is fine. I want it to go home anyway. I'm sat in his team meeting like Stevie Wonder. I've got dark glasses on because my eyes are all bloodshot and I've been crying.
Really?
And I got sent home. Rooster, Dave Roberts, I mentioned, amazing man. He got me fit mentally, physically and everything, went back and then played the one days at the end of the series. But when you talk at an end of World Cup after, which I did all right in.
How did you repair the relationship with Duncan?
It was never repaired. It was never.
That was it.
The relationship with me and Duncan was, it wasn't always bad. And to say he didn't help me through my career would be a lie because I think my best years for England was with him. I wouldn't say because of him, but maybe despite him.
Yeah.
But he did help me at certain times. And when I was playing well, he'd talk to me and we was all right. When I wasn't playing particularly well, it was almost as if I'm the reason why the team were getting beat.
But he gave you the silent treatment.
Oh, yeah, not just me.
Yeah.
And I don't want to talk ill of him, but we had a shocking relationship. Well, that's one thing that really stands out with Burn.
You know, so going back to Fred about criticism,
Duncan, I don't want to make this, because I mentioned him quite a bit, I don't want to make this about him and Duncan, because I've got no problem with him.
Yeah.
And like I said, I had my best years playing under him, despite this fractious relationship.
Yeah.
And I reckon, you know what, I'd like to see him now.
And talk about it. Be interesting to hear his point of view, because I wonder whether...
Could we not get him on as a guest?
You won't get a word out.
But maybe the medical staff didn't give him enough information about how much you were struggling,
means you can't run.
Yeah, but it just doesn't make any sense.
I was doing my rehab in gym with Darren Goff. Goff was taking my rehab for me. It's weird.
You know, on that, so about criticism and... I'm with Fred that I could take all the criticism in the world if it was fair. And talking about hernias, when I moved to Blackburn, in about my third or fourth game, we played Norwich. We won 3-0. I went into the corner and I went into a tackle, won the ball, the crowd got up, and I felt something go in my groin.
Yeah.
Anyway, the next day I woke up, it was a bit sore. Anyway, you've got tendons on your... from your groin, which go onto your hip bone, and it, anyway, I ended up having a tenotomy.
What?
A tenotomy. So what they do is, for instance, listen, so it's true. So near your scrotum, the groin there, you've got a tendon, which when you run, it moves up and down.
Yep.
So what I'd done was, this was really hurting me. Anyway, the physio at Blackburn was amazing. Dave Fever, and because I was a bit of a hypochondriac, because I was a bit. You know, oh no, I'm going to be out for ages. I played through it and played through it. And I remember in training, it comes to a point when I couldn't move.
Yep.
But in my head, I was taking painkillers, I was taking this, and I was getting criticised off the fellow professionals.
Yep.
I remember Brad Friedel. So he threw a ball out, and I didn't trap me runner because I couldn't. And he absolutely hammered me. And I was thinking, I can't move.
Yeah.
I can't move. And I was saying to everybody, I need an operation. Something's not right. Anyway... They said, go rest over the summer. But I was on holiday and I knew it wasn't right. So I had to phone up the manager. I phoned him up and said, I need an operation. I need an operation. I've got to go in because I know, come back, it won't be right.
Yep.
So I phoned up the physio, phoned up the doctor. They put me into to the surgeon. And when he opened me up, I had a huge piece of grit
in between the tendon and the bone, which was rubbing. Therefore, I knew the criticism which they were giving me was my own fault because I knew I was injured. I couldn't move. So that criticism really hurt me. And I was going home every night so frustrated because I knew if I was fit and I was firing all cylinders, I wouldn't be getting that questioned off my teammates.
And don't you think this is a bit that the fans don't see? They don't know what you're going through behind the scenes. They don't know the injury you're carrying. They don't know the pain you're experiencing. And they think, oh, you know, this person over here, he's not running fast enough or he's not warming up properly. Or they don't know about the bit of grit. It's not funny, but the bit of grit in your scrotum.
It's when I broke my neck.
Near it.
Your neck?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, it's when I broke my neck playing for Birmingham. And I played with that for 6-7 weeks.
Broken neck.
Look at the scar there. So basically, it's out of criticism. I wasn't right. I was playing with it.
This is Flintoff, Savage and the Ping Pong Guy.
More live Premier League football than anyone else. This is BBC Five Live.
With the BBC News on Five Live at 1:30, I'm Rob Watts. The Cabinet Office is investigating whether the International Trade Minister, Mark Garnier, breached the ministerial code. He's admitted asking a secretary to buy sex toys, but told a newspaper it didn't amount to sexual harassment. Theresa May is to ask the Commons Speaker for advice on new ways staff can report abuse. A huge rally against independence is taking place in Catalonia. There are claims as many as 300,000 people have taken to the streets of Barcelona. The Chair of Parliament's Environmental Audit Committee, Mary Cray, says a Five Live investigation has shown the current MOT test is not fit for purpose. We've discovered thousands of diesel drivers are removing filters aimed at cutting air pollution and going undetected. The Greater Manchester Police say two nightclub doormen are likely to have suffered permanent skin damage after an apparent acid attack. They'd been removing a man from a club in Salford at around 3:45 this morning.
Thank you, Rob. Five Live Sport, back for more award-winning chat with Flintoff, Savage and the Ping Pong Guy in just a moment. In the meantime, in the Premier League, just underway at the Amex. Brighton, Southampton. Here's Alistair Bruce-Ball.
Yes, 90 seconds played in the sunshine on the south coast. Brighton 0, Southampton 0. Brighton unchanged after their excellent 3-0 win at West Ham. Sofiane Boufal, after that fabulous goal against West Brom last time out, has started for them. Nadim Anuaha, the QPR player, is sitting alongside me in the commentary position. And Nadim, you will have played against Brighton relatively recently. What have you made of their start to the Premier League season?
I think it's been pretty impressive so far. Having played against them recently, as you say, they were always solid. And I think coming into the Premier League, you can see they're still just as competitive now. They've got a good setup, they've got a good manager in play, and I think the players definitely know what they're doing.
Early stages, Brighton 0, Southampton 0.
In the Championship, second half of Birmingham City against Aston Villa in the derby at St Andrews, here's Robin Cowan.
Still 0-0, 71 minutes on the clock. A good chance for both sides in this second half. Hotter for Birmingham, intercepted a loose pass in the Villa half. He dribbled through one-on-one and blasted over the bar. Down the other end, Codger had a header brilliantly saved by Cusack. Tipped it over the bar, still 0-0 here.
Women's Super League One, it's currently Manchester City 0, Birmingham City 1. Into the second half there, you can watch it on the red button or through the BBC Sport website and app. Our commentary match in WSL 1 is Everton-Arsenal, which starts at 2 o'clock, same time as Chelsea-Yeovil, incidentally. Joe Curry is going to be watching this one for us.
Yes, afternoon, Jonathan. Well, after Arsenal dismissed their manager Pedro Martinez-Losa midweek following 3 years in charge at the club, today they begin life under interim boss Ismael Garcia. But with them sat seventh in the table with only 4 points from the opening three matches, it's easy to see why the club felt a change of manager was necessary as they tried to mount a late title challenge. Today they face a team at Everton who sit second from bottom in the WSL 1 table and who are yet to win any points so far, having moved up from WSL 2 last year. The team news is in. The big news for Arsenal is that the England striker Jodie Taylor doesn't start, she starts on the bench. Kickoff here is at 2 p.m.
And Sports Extra coverage begins just before 2 o'clock. Right now, as I say, you can watch Manchester City, Birmingham City through the red button, or you can watch NFL at Twickenham on BBC Two. Minnesota Vikings, Cleveland Browns just getting underway. Elsewhere today, England have reduced the deficit in the Women's Ashes to 2 points with victory over Australia in the third one-day international. Justin Rose has won the HSBC Champions Golf in Shanghai, that despite being 8 shots off the lead going into the final round. Lewis Hamilton needs to finish fifth or better in the Mexico Grand Prix to win the Drivers' World Championship for a fourth time. He'll start third on the grid. Commentary on Five Live from 6 o'clock this evening. And still to come on Five Live Sport, we'll look back on last night's boxing in Cardiff with Mike Costello and Steve Bunce. But next, part two of the latest episode of Flintoff Savage and the Ping Pong Guy.
This is BBC Five Live on digital, online, smartphone and tablet.
A quick look at the roads in Glasgow on the M8 eastbound. There's queuing traffic because of an earlier broken down vehicle between Junction 20 for Kingston Bridge and Junction 19 for Anderson Cross. There's also congestion as far as Junction 22. And on the M1 in Bedfordshire southbound, there's a lane closed in queuing traffic because of a car fire between Junction 12 for Flitwick and 11 for Luton. It's adding about 3/4 of an hour to your journey. Rob Watts, Five Live Travel.
Get more from BBC Five Live with Five Live Podcasts. Just released, Bunce's Tales of the Extraordinary.
I'm Steve Bunce, and in this new podcast, Caroline Barker and I discuss some fascinating stories of sporting endeavour.
There are men fighting bears, bonkers winter Olympian playboys, and countries going to war over a game of football.
It's all in Bunce's Tales of the Extraordinary.
Search Five Live in your podcast app.
Get more from BBC Five Live.
This is Flintoff, Savage and the Ping Pong Guy.
You know, on that tour of Australia, right, they tried everything to get me fit and it won't work. They injected everything in me.
Did you resent this, by the way, that you were being put through so much rehabilitation and quite intrusive?
But do you know the worst thing about it is, if I tell you I'm hurting...
You're hurting.
Yeah. I'm really hurting. Right. I'm not here... I don't want to rub. I don't like being rubbed. If I'm telling you I'm hurting, I'm hurting.
Yeah.
They tried to get me fit and they tried everything. And then I was in Tasmania. And then they come up with this new thing and they say... It's a pubis symphysis.
Oh, that's...
It's not when plants go towards the light.
It's in between, isn't it?
Yeah, it's above your willy, right? There's like the bone and there's a hole on your pelvis.
Uh-huh.
And what they said was we can inject through there and inject some painkiller into your pubis symphysis to see if it works. So I'm thinking, well, you've tried everything else. Go on then. So I've been told this is going to work. I go in this room in Tasmania in hospital and I'm led on this bed and I've got this towel over me. Oh. In comes this little Chinese doctor and two nurses.
Yeah.
And he says, right, he gets this needle out and it's a massive big needle. And I'm thinking, where's he going to put that? So he moves the towel. Don't get me wrong, I'm slightly nervous.
Yeah.
So he's then started putting this needle in and I let out the biggest scream of my life. And he said, has the anaesthetic worked yet? I'm thinking, I don't think so, mate, I don't think so. Yeah. And that's what they tried. That didn't work. Yeah. They tried everything. So,
and it was the injection, like, unbelievably painful. I mean, that sounds horrible. Such a sense of...
horrific. Speak to anybody who's had that, it's horrific.
But isn't it interesting? Looking back, you think, why would you want to go through it?
Oh,
but
I played
Australian Open 1998. Yeah. Don't hammer me for the table tennis story. And I was playing Peter Karlsson, Swedish guy, top 10 of the world, but I knew I had a chance to beat him. And I had a massive, unbelievable pain in my foot. And the physio tried everything. It was at the Melbourne Sports and Aquatic Centre, beautiful venue. And they said, there is one possible way you might be able to play. We could give you a local anaesthetic straight through the base of your foot, the sole of your foot, which is a really sensitive part of the body. And I was on in like an hour and a half. And I said, won't it numb the whole of my leg? How will I be able to move? They said, we're going to make it very local to that bit of the foot. Got to tell you, lying on that couch and then a doctor coming out with this long needle, I just closed my eyes and I thought, you go through a lot, don't you, to try and reach the Melbourne sport. Yeah. You do have tough times. And I thought, you know what? It's going to be 5 seconds of excruciating pain, but it might give me a chance to win. I played. First game, I couldn't feel my foot. I lost.
I couldn't feel my feet. What's that, this?
Go with the injecting yours.
But then I went 2 down, came back and won 3-2. But it's fascinating, this, just going through all of this.
I know we got off subject a little bit, but it's like when I was playing for Birmingham at Charlton, and I've got up for a header, and I've landed on my arms. Like, you know, when you stop yourself.
Yeah.
And there was this big shudder through my body, right? And I've gone off afterwards. I've played the last half an hour, and I've said to the physio, I've got pins and needles in my arms. I said, you know, like you scrunch your hands together. Anyway, I lay on the bed. The doctor come in, and he said, you've jarred your nerve.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, right. Anyway, when I look back now, it's so frightening, and I can't believe, you know, I've not spoken about this, have I, before?
No.
Anyway, it was in my book. Mm-hmm. So... Anyway, I've said...
So no one's seen it.
He's horrible, see? Val will be on to you. Val listen to this. That's my brother. Val's going to send me a text. So, anyway, the Monday, I've gone into the training ground and said, these pins and needles, I was struggling to put my hands in cold water. And they said, you've jarred a nerve. this minute, I was having lying back on the physio table, and the physio would get my head in his hands, and he's like,
"Oh, wow, thanks, you said hands."
Right? And he'd
everyone just went,
and he'd click it, and he was like, "You're like a chiropractor," and it was click. So I'd go out to training, but this pins and needles never went away, and I would get, but my neck, no pain in my neck, it was just pins and needles down both arms. Anyway, this is true. So 6 weeks, end of the season, I had this pins and needles, but I thought it's a jarred nerve. That's what I was told. Therefore, I was going to be fine. The summer, 6 weeks off. Nerves take ages to repair. Yeah. I thought, right. So we had a testimonial game at Cardiff. We were going, playing against Cardiff, testimonial for some guy. After that, we were off for 6 weeks.
Yep.
In the warm-up, you imagine this, and it's horrible. In the warm-up, and it's not an exaggeration, I was just, you know, just getting ready to play, and I think it was Damian Johnson just come behind me and like, jokingly nudged me in the back.
Yeah.
I fell to the ground, and I couldn't feel my body for 20 seconds.
No.
On my kid's life. I what? Could not feel my body for 20 seconds.
Kind of paralysis.
I couldn't move. I could not move.
Was you trying to move?
I couldn't move. So I've got up, and honestly, what's that? You never seen the advert, Mr. Soft? That Mr. Yeah. Soft, and he was...
Yeah, it's for mince, isn't it?
Mince, yeah. It was like, I was like, my legs were wobbling, and I've gone into the change room, and I said to the physio, not being funny, not going to believe this, remember I was a bit of a hypochondriac? I said, I couldn't move for 20 seconds. He was like, yeah, all right, go and play the first half.
No.
Played the first half, and then this pain now in my arms.
Is it the best game you've ever had? Robbie's moving. Robbie's moving more.
Might be horrible. Oh, sorry. You're in a bad mood today, yeah. Anyway. You're horrible, yeah. Friend is. Yeah,
I'm just sticking up for Matthew.
So anyway, I'm on the bus going back. I said, listen, I'm going away tomorrow for 6 weeks. I need to go to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
I can't put up with this pain anymore. It's horrific pain in my arms. So I go in the scanner. So they put me into the Birmingham hospital. I'm in a scanner.
What, like MRI?
MRI scanner. And you can when you've got these headphones on in a scanner, and it's going...
Them really tight tubes.
Yeah, them tight tubes.
It's claustrophobic, isn't it?
Yeah. Tape your nose down.
You're enjoying this, aren't you? Like,
Matthew said to me before, I'll give Robbie some. I'll get it next time.
Why is he getting it?
No, it's fair. I mean, it's did though. Yeah,
so anyway, you know what? So you can see the glass where the people are doing the scan, and I knew something was wrong. Anyway, as the bed comes out of the MRI scan, it was like...
What, because they were sort of discussing it?
You could see, It was like, right, you've got to like stay there. So basically... I was then told that I had a C5, I think it is. It was, the disc was 70% in my spinal cord.
So how long had that been going on for?
6 weeks. So the disc...
If they hadn't done it, what would have happened?
So the doctor said to me, the doctor who I believe saved my career, I think his name was Mr. Jakubowski, I think.
Jakubowski?
Jakubowski.
I know him.
Yeah, he's a surgeon.
Yeah, because he said to me...
Yeah,
right,
a surgeon.
He said to me years ago... Because I was having back problems, and he scanned me, and he said, your tailbone hasn't fused.
Right.
I says, has it not? Right. He said, do you wet the bed? Seriously? I said, well, I did wet the bed till I was about 13 or 14, and then if I have too much to drink now, I'll wet the bed. And he said, that's because your tailbone hasn't fused. I said, well, that's great, but how's that going to help me bowl?
No way,
and
he
wanted to...
Jack about, yeah. So he said that it was 60...
I don't wet the bed now, just get out.
Yeah.
My disc was 60 to 70% of my spinal cord.
So it could have severed your spinal cord.
So he said, one more blow, and that could have been it.
It's just unbelievable.
So I had the operation, so they kept me in. I was in intensive care. They went through my neck there, took the bone from my hip, fused it in C5. So now, look, my move my neck's really, really... poor. So that's, I know we're going to have something,
but
this
honestly,
is what you, this is what you put yourself through, Matthew, to play, to be the best you can. And
so you think, broke your neck?
Was there any
fear that if you got a knock you won't be able to walk?
He said to me, if you get, before it was done, if I'd have gone away and then come back and not the operation, and I got whacked, that'd
have been it.
That'd have been it.
But
then the operation, was there any fear if they got it wrong?
No, fine. Fine.
No, but because when they're working around there, they say if they nick something.
Yeah, they tell you that. They go in the neck. And so it's quite a big scar.
Yeah.
But this is the thing. Athletes go through and people don't... And you might be off one day, but these are the things that people don't realise. So you might be playing with this thing. You might be not right for so many different reasons.
Yeah. Just to get back on track about unfair criticism, the one thing that really bothered me so much was Steve Armisen. You know, Steve Armisen, all the way through his career, when we talk about mental health and depression and struggling with things... And I saw him go through it every day. And I saw him get a kick in the press. I saw teammates having a go at him.
Yeah.
And that sort of thing would not happen now. But that really hurt and upset me. And I suppose in some ways, it didn't allow me to talk about how I was feeling. Yeah. And possibly people like Marcus Trzaskowski as well, who then just had a complete break. He just happened so fast and disappeared out of the way. But bear in mind, Steve Armisen had been going through that for probably 8 years beforehand.
Mm.
And nobody took the time or just hammered him. So there's two sides of criticism for me, where Mourinho, I think he's well within the right.
Yeah. Yeah.
But in other instances, like we've just spoken about...
Can be deeply unfair.
Yeah.
Fascinating topic that. Should we go on to the next one?
Can I have a quick wee?
Yeah.
It's not your tailbone, is it?
I don't know, but this chair might need washing.
Flintoff, Savage and the Ping Pong Guy.
So, Fred's back with us. Next topic. Fans, some pundits, have been talking about whether this Man City team could become one of the great sides ever to grace the Premier League. So let's discuss, what are our nominations for the greatest team ever in any sport?
What we're talking about, not a combined team,
no,
an actual team who've played.
And shall I still kick this one? I think the All Blacks is a good contender for this. They've got the best winning percentage.
The current one?
One All Black team. I mean, to be honest, in that case, it's been so good for such a long time. Yeah. You could pick out almost any All Black team from almost any decade since 19-whatever, and it would have been one of the best ever. But if I had to go for one, for the beauty that they brought to football, for the stellar lineup of talent, and I'm not talking about United under Ferguson, don't worry. I think Barcelona under Guardiola in particular were absolutely unbelievable. Since Iniesta started playing regularly in the first team in 2004-05, they've won the La Liga 8 times, Copa del Rey 5, Super Cup 7, European Cup 4, Iniesta 31 trophies. But that Barcelona side had a core Spanish lineup that also won the European Championships in 2008 and 2012, the World Cup in 2010. And I think the match they played against Madrid in 2010, November, they won 5-0. I think it's the most complete performance of any football team I've ever seen. Possession, the confidence on the ball, they would pass their way out of tight corners. And I'll give you the lineup quickly. Valdez, Alves, Puyol, what an
fantastic... It's like the Chipmunks, this. Alvin and the Chipmunks. What's going on? Alves, Valves, Theodore and who? Are you making these names up?
Valdez, Alves, Puyol, what a titan he was at the heart of defence. Pique, Abidal, Busquets, one of the most underrated players ever. Xavi, Iniesta, Pedro, Messi and Villa. And it's similar to the team that beat United in the 2011 Champions League final. What
Messi,
a match that header. Was. Brilliant.
I was there for
absolutely
that.
Absolutely brilliant.
I went to watch that.
No.
The Champions League final when they beat United.
Yeah.
I went, yeah.
Rooney scored, didn't he?
I got invited by Richard Bevan, who used to run the PCA cricket. Yep. Now he's
football.
Managers.
Yeah, League Managers Association.
And he got asked, and we went out all day, and I got in at, I got in about 4:30 in the morning, living down south. And the missus says, you're back late. I says, yeah, it's the late kickoff.
Shut up.
The Spanish TV.
Did you get away with it?
Do you know what? Yeah, I did. But do you know what? I remember that game watching it. And United were a good side, weren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
But even as a layman, don't know much about football, you could see.
Brilliant. Yeah. It's just beautiful. Well,
Messi's gone ahead in the other final against Man U, didn't he?
2009.
He's got a head in that game, didn't he?
Yeah, I think it was the 2009 final, wasn't it?
But can I ask a question about that team?
Yeah.
Right, this is one thing which I've never quite understood about managers in football, is that they always get sacked and they always get criticised for what they do, and I think, you know what, the players should be more accountable.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But then you look at that team, And then you talk about the way in which City are playing now and starting to play after Pep Guardiola has been there, what, it was over a year, nearly 2 years now. How much is down to, obviously you rhyme all them names off and a couple I've heard of, but I'm sure they're very good players. How much is down to Pep Guardiola as a manager and an ethos of how he wants to play, and how much is down to this amazing group of players?
I think that's really, really difficult to unravel, the combination of the two, because they are fantastic players. He inherited an amazing team, but he also took it to another level. I said in the last podcast I thought Guardiola was overrated, and a lot of people found that very, almost offensive, that this guy, this artist, who so creatively shaped Barcelona and now Manchester City in an exciting way, how can you be so pejorative about him? My honest opinion is that he is a good manager, a great manager, but sometimes we think that it's almost... that he created the team, and he definitely
didn't. But you spoke about how they played and how they played from their back and how they passed.
Yeah, beautiful.
Is that the players or the man? I don't know.
But remember, these players, the majority of them, came through La Masia. Is that how you pronounce it? The academy at Barcelona.
He doesn't know, does he? He's never heard of it.
He's looking...
He's thinking you're talking about the life of Brian. Hey.
But the possession that they played, I think, was largely a consequence of the way they were trained through the youth academy. So they developed the ability, particularly Xavi and Iniesta, but Busquets too. Messi was at the academy. So they developed the skills that you need in order to control and pass and perceive the patterns of players around you in order to, you know, play possession football. I think Guardiola added a couple of ingredients, but he wasn't fundamental to the skill that they had, but the way he shaped it was very
impressive. But joking aside about the class of 92... sounds very similar to what happened in that. How much were the players and how much were the...
The difference there, though, there's a massive difference in that Guardiola inherited this academy that had been created partly by Cruyff, but a long tradition at Barcelona. The Manchester United academy at the Cliff, you know, it was Ferguson, I think, who hired Eric Harrison. It was him. In his first day at United, he went to see Martin Edwards and Maurice Watkins, the lawyer, and they said, what are you going to be doing tomorrow? He said, forget tomorrow. I'm looking to the future. I want to build the foundations. He was always looking to the youth. So I think Ferguson should take credit for the class of 92 in a way that Guardiola perhaps not.
So your greatest team is Barcelona?
Yeah.
What year?
I would go 2010.
Right. Fred, greatest ever team?
Cricket, isn't it, for me?
Yeah.
And I think there's only two to pick from. One is the Australian team of the late 90s up until... they were knocked off the perch momentarily in 2005, but then came back just a year later.
Yeah.
When you look at that side, you had...
Brilliant.
Langer and Hayden opening the batting. Ricky Ponting, number three.
Fantastic.
Martin, four. Then Hussey came in at number five.
Yep. Mike Hussey.
Or Mike Hussey or Michael Clarke. Then you had Gilchrist.
Brilliant.
Unbelievable. Coming in at number seven. Warne, McGrath, Lee... and whoever else they wanted to pick. So that to me was a great team. But
Gillespie.
I reckon, Gillespie in his pomp. He tailed off probably 2005 onwards in his pomp. Brilliant. But then they were a good team. But I can't name the great West Indian teams of the early 80s.
What a team that.
Marshall, Garner.
Haynes and Greenwich. Clive Lloyd maybe just before that. Yeah. Gus Logie and all these guys.
Jeff Dujon and Wiki.
Richie Richardson.
But the team about the West Indies was different. Everyone now talks about England, Australia, the Ashes. It was West Indies were the tide to beat, and England came nowhere near beating them. They were unbelievable. And the thing about them which made them better was I think they were ahead of their time.
Yeah.
You looked at them, they were physically bigger, they were physically stronger. When cricketers historically weren't particularly fit and muscle-bound and had physiques, you look at the West Indies, they were different to everyone else. They were strong, they could bowl faster. The batsmen had more flair, they had more ability or more self-belief. And I think that's what made them better than everybody else in the world.
I'll just give you some stats to show how unbelievable that series was. The Australian side of the 2000s, between October 1999 and November 2007, they played 93 tests. They won 72. That is absolutely mind-boggling.
The 2005 Ashes.
Yeah, exactly. These guys. They played out only 11 draws in 93 games, which is incredible. And in 28 series, they won 24. and lost and drew two each. One of them was the iconic 2005 series. That, I think, is a tribute to one of the most extraordinary victories a home nation's had in the history of our sport, I think.
It was, but going into it, I don't know if we thought we could beat them. But getting back to the previous topic, which fuels it, is people saying you're not going to beat these.
That helped.
I mean, I got a bit hit. Yeah. That's what fueled it. And that side were unbelievable. When you played against some of them, and I look at my life and career after 2005, I've got a lot to thank that team for. Because, one, having the opportunity to play against them, beating them changed my life in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
And is life-changing on so many fronts. It's not just a sporting front, but I go and work in Australia now.
Yeah.
And I'm not ashamed to say it. It's off the back of that. There's no two ways about it. Yeah. BAFTA, Logie, you know what I name them. NBA, I'm not going to list them. three areas. But, yeah, to have the chance to play against that side, and you look at it, and you look at a career, and you think the high points, and there've been a few, but one, having the opportunity to play against the best and beating the best,
Who of that Australian team, if you had to pick out one player who was the most significant part of that team in terms of what you brought to the entire dynamic, the intimidatory effect, who do you think...
It's hard to pick one, isn't it?
Right.
Because you see Ricky Ponting, he's like a leader of men, unbelievable as a batsman, the best... I'm biased towards Tendulkar because I love him, but harder to bowl at Ponting. And he's a tough man. You know, he'd give you nothing, wouldn't look at you, wouldn't speak to you, just aggressive. Led his team. Shane Warne brings... everything Shane Warne does. Amazing bowler, but that character. Don't play the man, play the ball. Don't worry about him, but it's hard not to. He, like, lifted the team. And then I suppose the other one, which was the difference between winning the Ashes and losing them, was Adam Gilchrist.
Oh, what a player.
And I stumbled across a way of getting him out.
Go on.
Which was round the wicket, just nip it away from him. Off the seam, reverse swing, take it away from him. Because I've never said this, really, but I just... Everyone thinks I stumbled across it, and I did a little bit because I bowled quicker around the wicket because I get across my body and I could bowl faster to the left-hander.
For people who don't know about cricket, around the wicket is...
You bowl, you're running and you bowl. So if I'm looking at the wickets from the top of my run-up, over the wicket is on the left-hand side, and the left-handers, they used to come to the right-hand side to take it away. But I also looked at Adam Gilchrist, the way in which he set up, where if I come on the other side, his bat had never come down straight because he was facing the other way.
Yeah.
So there was a technical flaw which he had, which I exploited, but more through luck than judgment because I preferred to bowl on that side. But we took him out of that series, and I think that was the difference of winning and losing it.
Because he was a wicketkeeper. He averaged 50 with the bat.
Amazing. But the way in which he scored his runs took it away from you.
Oh, by the way, just to put a bit of context on the West Indies, remember this is a number of different nations that were playing as the West Indies, a number of different islands that had different jurisdictions.
Barbados, Antigua, Nevis.
And for a long time, people were saying it's Calypso cricket. They're not strong enough. They've not got the mental fortitude, you know, and they don't have the identity. They're not a team. They're just a gang. And they went, I think, to Australia early 70s, and they were ripped to shreds by Lillian Thompson. And it was a really tough time. They lacked self-belief. And then Clive Lloyd, who you mentioned, who was the captain, he said, right, we've got to have a savage, tough bowling attack. And they really honed their skills. And I think it was a big part of how they developed self-confidence as a group of nations. They found that confidence through the success of the cricket team.
This might be a bit controversial, but...
Oh, it's not Birmingham, is it?
not far off. So the greatest ever side for me, and we're talking about on a year, so you can... Barcelona, this team, for me, is the greatest ever side because I believe it's the greatest ever achievement. Leicester City. You can talk about your Barcelones. You can talk about playing beautiful football.
I like that.
We can talk about Brazil 1970.
Yep.
Unbelievable. Brilliant. Unbelievable. We can talk about the treble Manchester United team. You can talk about the All Blacks. You can talk about... For the greatest ever team to have the greatest ever achievement, it has to be Leicester City because everybody was saying they're not going to win it. I was even saying 2 weeks for 3 weeks before they're not going to win it. For a group of players to play... beyond themselves for 38 games.
It's amazing, isn't it?
For players who were released by other clubs, for players where transfer fees were like under £1 million, for players who were written off, for a manager who come there and galvanised them, and for the fact they become everybody's second favourite side, they were battering good teams. Everybody made excuses for the other sides. Well, you know, it was a bad season. Everybody said everything went right for Leicester, injuries and no suspensions, all this. But for those players... who now are probably where they are, But they're a bottom half table Premier League side. Yeah. They were in League One 3 or 4 years, so the Championship 3 or 4 years before. 5,000 to 1, they've won the Premier League. It'll never happen again because the other teams have gone, oof, hang on a minute. That has to be the greatest ever side. And people say I'm talking nonsense, and I use that word a lot. But I can't, they didn't have the flair, they didn't have the, you know, when people say greatest ever side, the All Blacks, of course, unbelievable. Barcelona, beautiful, panache, playing out from the back. This was a side who got the ball, they whipped it into the channel, and Vardy would score. Brilliant. It was simple, dynamic, unbelievable. Yeah. So for me, the greatest ever side.
Passionate about this, aren't you?
Yeah, it's a great
because
shout.
The
as
greatest
well.
Ever side has to be 5,000 to 1 odds
for that period of time. We're not saying they're going to go down in history as the greatest ever team.
No, but for me,
for that period of time, Leicester City.
Yeah, and you could sort of say the greatest team in terms of raising their games above expectation. I don't think anyone's ever done anything even remotely comparable to it. Mike's shouting
it's
Nottingham
like
Forest.
It's
no
like
way.
Winning, it's like winning Grand Prix with Fiesta, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But
it is. Our producer just said Nottingham Forest back-to-back European Cups.
Not close to Leicester.
That's another debate for another show. Yeah. Nottingham Forest or Leicester City. Because Brian Clough, to win back-to-back European Cups, 1979-80, wasn't it? And that was a period when English sides won it for 4 or 5 years running. Liverpool, Villa, Nottingham Forest twice. And that's a debate, Nottingham Forest or Leicester City. But I've got to say, to go over 38 games and in the spending powers of the big six, whatever, for Leicester to upset it at all, I'm saying the greatest ever period, the greatest ever side for me, Leicester City.
Wonderful. Brilliant, brilliant. Thank you for listening. You can download the podcast for extended versions of all the topics we covered on this week's show at the 5 Live website and all the usual podcast places. Also, every show we've ever done to date, all the award-winning shows available to download there. Please use the hashtag FredSavSide to get in touch through the week. If you can leave a review on iTunes and give us a rating, we'd really appreciate it. For now, from all of us, goodbye.
Thank you. Meanwhile, in the Premier League, Southampton have taken the lead against Brighton. Stephen Davis with an early goal there will be at the Amex very shortly. And the final whistle has blown in the Championship. Birmingham, Aston Villa. How's it finished? Robin Cowan.
It's finished. Aston Villa, Birmingham 0, Aston Villa 0. The 125th second City derby. Not one that will live long in the memory. The best opportunities came in the second half. Potter should have given Birmingham the lead. He did brilliantly to intercept a poor pass in the Villa defensive third, but he smashed it over the bar when one-on-one with the keeper. Villa twice at the bar in the latter stages. First substitute Keenan Davis and then Jonathan Codger. The result doesn't really help either side's causes, but wasteful finishing from both sides is to blame. It's finished. Birmingham 0, Aston Villa 0.
Reaction later in the programme. Everton-Arsenal underway now on Sports Extra in WSL1. If you want to listen to that here on 5 Live Sport, Costello and Bunce will join us shortly to talk all things boxing. Your verdict on Anthony Joshua's performance and indeed who he should take on next. 850-58 or at 5 Live Sport if you want to get involved in our boxing chat. And as I say, we'll head to Brighton very shortly as Brighton trail Southampton 1-0 in the Premier League. Right now, 2 minutes past two, here's Rob Watts with the news.
More live Premier League football than anyone else. This is BBC Five Live.
The International Trade Minister, Marc Garnier, is being investigated after he admitted asking his secretary to buy sex toys. The revelations follow wider claims of sexual harassment at Westminster. Jonathan Blake is our political correspondent.
Now, Mr. Garnier has not denied these accusations. He's told the newspaper that he will take it on the chin, but he's described it as high jinks and says that it does not constitute harassment.
A 16-year-old boy has died after apparently taking an ecstasy-like tablet at a Halloween rave near Conway. North Wales police say he died from an overdose early this morning. It's believed he took a pink pill in the shape of the Rolls-Royce logo. The Chair of Parliament's Environmental Audit Committee says a 5 Live investigation into the removal of pollution filters from some diesel cars shows the MOT test isn't fit for purpose. Mary Cray was commenting on findings that thousands of drivers may be illegally removing the DPFs, but it's not being picked up. The Spanish government says 1 million people have taken to the streets of Barcelona in support of unification. The protest follows Catalonia's declaration of independence on Friday. The Labour MP Hilary Benn chairs the Commons Brexit Committee.
No country has recognised it. I don't see any country recognising it. Are there going to be borders? Is it going to be an army? The fact is there will have to be some agreement. Catalonia already has had a high degree of autonomy. It may like some more. And that, it seems to me, if you look at the experience here in the United Kingdom, that is the way to go.
It's being reported that the BBC has suspended Five Live presenter George Riley following claims that a number of women have complained about his behaviour. The BBC says it can't comment on individual staff members. George Riley has yet to comment on the claims. And strong winds of more than 100 miles an hour have been causing problems across central Europe. The storm has cut power lines and disrupted road and rail travel in the Czech Republic, Poland and parts of Germany.
BBC Sport.
It's that time. We're back. FA Cup Round 1. This is our tournament. This cup